Hi guys, this is our course approach 365 and I welcome you all in the plus Pramesh eLib. Okay, so we are having a course that is daily current affairs course, and today is November 9, 2019. Today is a historical day because the Ayodhya verdict is on the way, and I just want you guys to be safe, secure and have the compassion with one another in our nation, because peace is important. Okay, and in this news we are having sources, the Hindu PIB and the miscellaneous, and I'm saying this being a journalist, it's my responsibility to aware the citizens of the nation. Okay, and my name is Shubhangini Dubey. All right, then in this video we are going to discuss some topics. The first is Moody's rating, the second one is Punjab preservation of Subsoil Water Act 2009, then Brus of Mizo, then the ethanol production, then India justice report, and then Feni river and its significance. Okay, so starting with the Moody's rating, so basically there is a global rating agency that is Moody's investigator service, and recently it has just cut down the government of India's rating to negative, which was earlier stable. All right, so now earlier it was stable and now it has cut down to negative, but it has been affirmed the Baa2 foreign currency and local currency long term issuer rating. So basically Baa2 is a kind of ratings. We are going to discuss this in the next slides. Okay, so what is Moody's investigation service? It rates the debt securities. Okay, so basically it rates the debt securities, how much security is deposited by the country. Okay, so in Moody's investigator service rating system, securities are assigned a rating from AAA to C. So these are the rating system which are designed by the AAA to C, with AAA being the highest quality, and this is the highest quality that the this much security debt has been submitted with AAA, and C is the lowest quality. Okay, so we are somehow in the negative level. Once it was stable, but now it has cut down to the lowest level. Okay, so this is the image of the news. Moody's downgrades India's credit rating outlook to negative from stable. Okay, now what this means for India? So basically it is the outlook to negative inflects increasing risk that economic growth will remain materially lower than the past. So basically if it is going from stable to negative, economic growth can be lower. Okay, it will reflect lower government and policy effectiveness at addressing long standing economic and institutional weakness. So basically it is going to have the lower government and policy effectiveness. Okay, then institutional weakness, then Moody's have previously estimated, leading to a gradual rise in the debt burden from already high level. So basically it will also lead to a greater debt burden which was already high earlier. So this is about it. Then reduction outlook is the first step towards an investment downgrade. So basically if this is happening, if security deposit less, it's going in negative, then it will be also lower the investment procedures. Okay, so people will not invest, people do not investment because security debts are low. Okay, as India is now just a notch above the investment grade country rating, an actual downgrade in country's rating can lead to massive foreign funds overflow. So somehow because of the less security debt deposits, most of the countries can take out their money, okay, from the country itself, so that it will downgrade the country rating, which can lead to massive foreign fund outflows. That means massive foreign currencies can go out because there are no security debt with the nation. Now why has Moody's cut rating? Why, what is the reason that Moody has cut rating? That because recently Moody projected the fiscal deficit of 3.7% of the GDP in the year through March 2020, but then a breach of government targets of 3.3% as slower growth and a surprise corporate tax cut curb revenue. So basically there was a surprise because India became the country with the lowest corporate taxes, and all this happened, and that's why Moody was binding to cut the India's that debt securities and that ranking, global ranking, to from stable to negative. Then India's growth outlook has deteriorated sharply this year, as we know that India's growth has deteriorated this year with a crunch that is started, that in non-banking financial instrument spreading to retail business, car marketer, home sales and heavy industries. Okay, so these are happening. Moody said that outlook partly reflects government and policy ineffectiveness and addressing economic weakness. So basically Moody said that there is an economic weakness and increase in debt burden is also high, and this is the reason why they have cut it. Okay, now India's economy grew by 5% between April and June, its weakest pace since 2013, as consumer demand and government spending slowed amid global restrictions. So basically this is it, because in April June economies grew by 5% at its weakest. Okay, it was weakest since 2013, and this was one of the parameter of this rate cutting. Now, what is government say about this? So, noting the Moody's concern, finance ministry said that India continues to be among the fast and growing major economies. Obviously, government is always optimistic there, and India's relative standing remain unaffected. So, whatever is happening and whatever the rating is there, government will be staying at its point that India is still the fastest growing economy. And yes, one more thing is there. When we are having a type of development, then these things happens. Okay, we are purchasing the defense, we are empowering the defense of India, we are empowering the service sector, we are empowering the corporate sector. So somehow it can be obvious too. Okay, so it is not only the parameter of nation's development that GDP is getting low. All right, then government said that it has undertaken series of financial sectors and other reforms to strengthen the economy as a whole. Okay, so it also proactively taken policy decision in response to the global slowdown. So the government is also saying that policy decision is response is also important, which is resulting in the global slowdown. So if there is a policy which is regulating in the world, so somehow they are also getting affected. Then the fundamentals of economy remain quite robust with inflation under check and bond yield low. Okay, so these are the things which are government is saying for saving themselves, we can say. Now we are going to discuss the different general ratings of the Moody's. So basically AAA is the highest, as we have discussed earlier, and C was the lowest. Okay, later on AA plus, AA and A negative. So this AA plus is the highest credit quality, AAA is the highest credit quality, then it is AA plus, then AA, then AA negative. Very high credit quality is AA plus, then AA rating denotes expectation of very low default reserves. They indicate very strong capacity of payment and financial commitment. Then A plus and AA. A plus is the high credit quality that denotes expectation of low default risk. Low default risk will be there. The capacity for payment of financial commitment is considered strong. Still they are considered strong. Okay, then there is a BBB plus, BBB and B negative. So good credit quality that indicates the expectation of default risk are currently low. So these are some ratings. It's not necessary to mug up all this, but at least we have to know about it, that these are the ratings which are divided in the Moody's credit ratings. Okay, A plus, B plus, B, C, triple C plus, triple C, C, triple C negative, C, C, C. Then DDD, RD, SD, DDD. So basically, till C it is the lowest, but then the triple D, RD, SD indicates other factors. Okay, other indications are there, such as bankruptcy filing, administration, receivership, liquidation, and other formal winding up procedures and seized business. Okay, so these are about the it. Now moving on to the next topic, Punjab. Preservation of Subsoil Water Act 2019. Why we are discussing it? Because the Punjab Preservation of Subsoil Water Act 2009 is being blamed for contributing to the air pollution over Delhi and the surrounding areas. So obviously Delhi is in dangerous condition already. There is a public emergency in Delhi because of the air pollution. Recently it happened. So one of the thing that is Punjab Preservation of Subsoil Water Act is somehow polluting the Delhi and the surrounding areas. Now why it is? Because the law led to sowing and transplantation of summer paddy crop to be delayed by about a fortnight and moved the harvesting season to end October and nearly November, a time when the moist air and largely inactive and system cause particulate matter and gases from burning paddy subtle to hang in atmosphere. So basically this is the reason that somehow they are going to harvest season to end November and the end October and the early November. So later, a time when the air moist and largely inactive matters will be flowing in the air. So this is the reason when this will happen, then that burn out paddy will hang in the Atmosphere. So this air is carried by northwesterly wind. So the wind will be north in the northwest direction, which will lead to the Delhi and southeast of the Punjab. So this is about the act. Now, what is Punjab Preservation of Soil Act 2019? We have already discussed, but it is aimed at conserving groundwater by mentally delaying the transplantation of paddy. So it is the conserving the groundwater. A delay in the transplanting of paddy will be by June 10, when the most severe phase of evapotranspiration, transfer of water from land to atmosphere through evaporation from soil and plant transpiration, is over. Okay. Evapotranspiration is there. Okay, beyond June 10. Now, what is evapotranspiration? It is when water from land comes to atmosphere through evaporation. Okay, there is a water in land and it comes to the atmosphere through evaporation from the soil. From the soil it's coming, and then leaves are getting water from that evaporated water. That is evapotranspiration. Having an example that a paddy has been sown. Okay, so they are having plants which are sown, they are moving upward, and now there is an evaporation. Mm-hmm. There are the sun rays, okay, which are directly coming to the atmosphere, and in the ground level they are evaporating the water, and because of that evaporation there is an evaporation, and still the water vapors are in the atmosphere. And plants are taking water with the help of those water vapor, that is evapotranspiration. Okay, so farmers were forbidden from sowing paddy before May 10. So before May 10, they can't sow paddy, and transplantation it before June 10. So before June 10, they have to transplant, but not before May 10. Okay, so this law was enacted, and there has been serious concern over drastic fall in the water table in Punjab. And the cultivation of paddy leads to over-exploitation of underground aquifer. So basically that there is a drastic fall in the water in the Punjab area. And somehow this law was enacted because of the over-exploitation of underground aquifers. Okay. So as a very large number of tube wells, more than 14 lakh in 2015, running on free power pump out virtually endless amounts of water. So somehow even we can see that there are so many tube wells in Punjab area. Okay, so that's why this law was enacted. Now, it was believed that the early transplanting of rice resulted in unsubstantial withdrawal of underground water. With the monsoon still far, temperatures were high, and the evapotranspiration rate at its peak. Okay, hence this law is put in place. So, it was believed, somehow it was a belief that the early transplantation of rice, if rice will be sown before May 10th, okay, so it will result in unusual usage of underground water. Okay, paddy will be soaring, or paddy will be absorbing unsustainable withdrawal of water, and monsoon will be still far, and so that evapotranspiration will be its peak, and that is why June, before June 10 and after 10 May was the time which was decided. Okay, now what is the law link with the air pollution? Air pollution, why it is? Because late sowing and transplanting delays the harvesting too. The late harvesting will be there, and then a small window to field for the next wind, and then they have to burn it out. So somehow it is creating the air pollution. Okay, now you just can read it out. It is very simple, but not that much to mug up and okay. Now, but does the act really help conserve what underground? So, a study has reported a robust effect of the 2009 act on reducing the underground water depletion. So, this is like, is it really happening? So, a study is saying that yes, somehow it is happening to conserve the underground water. Okay, so there was in 2008 and 9 when the law was not enacted, the average annual rate of decline of water was 0.7, less than 0.9 m during the period 2000 and 2001. But now it is not that much. Okay, so this is about it. So according to the report in May 2019, there was a report in May 2019 by the Central Groundwater Board under the Ministry of Jal Shakti. 105 out of 138 blocks are in the dark zone. So this was the report, that 105 out of 138 blocks were in dark zone. At current rates of depletion, good quality air in the first aquifer up to depth of 100 meters shall be exhausted in 10 years. So this is about it. and the entire subsurface water resource could be finished in the next 22 years. Okay, so in next 22 years, it could be finished. Okay. Now, moving on to the second topic, Brus of Mizo. Why we are discussing it? Because nearly 32,000 Brus living in Tripura camp, which are living from year 1997, will be affected if government has already decided to stop food supply and the cash dole. So this is about the Brus of Mizo. So basically, the Tripura government recently announced that it would resort food supplies, leading to the Brus withdrawing a road block hold they had set up for the 8 days. Okay, so they are deciding to withdraw the road blockade. Okay, so restoration of supply, however, is only until a deadline of November 30. So restoration of supply is till November 30, within which Brus have to decide whether they will accept a package for repatriation to Mizoram. So it is like yes, Tripura government will restore food supplies. So this is about which will withdraw the Brus. Okay, now who are Brus? Brus are also referred to the Rangins, which are spread across the northeastern state of Tripura, Assam, Manipur and the Mizoram. So I think this is quite clear that somehow Tripura camp, the government has decided to stop food supply and the cash dole. This is about it. Okay, now as referred to the Rangins, it will be pronounced as Rangins. Okay, so they are spread in the northeastern state of Tripura, Assam, Manipur and the Mizoram. Okay, they are also recognized as a particular vulnerable tribal group. Brus are vulnerable tribal group. In Mizoram, they have been targeted by a group that does not consider them indigenous to the state. So they are also targeted, as many of the people are not considering them as a part of a state. Okay, now what is the issue? So ethnic volcanism is there. Obviously, these are the issues with the other categories. Okay, ethnic violence, thousands of people from Brus tribe to leave their home in Mizoram. So many Brus tribes, thousands of Brus tribes were forced to leave their home in Mizoram. As many as 32,876 people are living in refugee camp in the Jimpui hill of Tripura. Okay, so this is about it. It's such amount of people are there. Then displaced Brus people from Mizoram have been living in various camps in Tripura since 1997. Okay, so there are so many who are living in refugee camps, and in 1997, murder of Mizo forest guard at Dampa Tiger Reserve were also there in Mizoram. So there is especially the ethnic violence, we can say. The Brew militancy was a reactionary movement against Mizo nationalist group who had demanded the mid-90s that the Brews be left out to the state editorial roles, contending that the tribe was not indigenous to Mizoram. So that they are not, people of Mizoram are not accepting them as their own people. And this is the overall issue in the layman language. Now moving on to the next topic, why government is encouraging ethanol production. Okay, so why we are discussing it? Because recently the Ministry of Environment and the Forest has announced that mills would not require separate environmental clearance to produce additional ethanol from B-heavy molasses. Okay, molasses is the remaining of the sugary products. Okay, sugar, in the manufacturing of sugar and sugar cane is molasses. Okay, so what are ethanol and molasses? So basically ethanol, which is also known as ethyl alcohol, is a liquid that has several uses. Okay, so it has several uses. One of them is at its 95% purity. Like just like petroleum, there is a purity level. There is also purity level in the ethanol. Alright, so at 95% purity, it is called rectified spirit. It is a spirit which can be used as an intoxicating ingredient in the alcohol. Okay, then at the 99%, they are blending with the petrol. Ethanol will be blended with the petrol. Both products are made from molasses. Okay, so this will be made from molasses. And then a byproduct of sugar manufacturing. So basically this will be it. For making sugar, milk, crushed sugar cane, which typically has total fermentable sugars content of 14%. So this will be it. The TFS component consists of sucrose along with this is not an important point. I had already read it. This is not the important one. Alright. Then there are so many molasses stages. Okay. A, B, C, the last one being where the molasses are most uncrystallized and non-recoverable. Okay, the C molasses roughly constitute 4.5% of the cane and have remaining TFS of 40%. Okay, so total fermentation point is there, TFS is okay. So in these are the categories, three stages, so A category, B category and the C category. All right, now how more ethanol can be produced? It is also an important point that 1 ton of cane milk can produce 150 kg of sugar. 1 ton of cane milk can produce, cane milk, sugar cane milk can produce 115 kg of sugar at 11.5% recovery and 45 kg of mol gas, that gives it 10.8 liters of ethanol. So from that molasses ethanol is produced, which is also known as ethyl alcohol. Okay, now how more ethanol can be produced? So this is just read it out, it is not that important, so I will leave that point. So there are intermediate options as well, so we are not going to discuss that how it can. Now why focus my focus on more on ethanol, this is important. Okay, so mills currently have all-time high stock of sugar. Obviously mills have all-time high stock of sugar and they have been at loggerhead with the farmers or non-payment of dues. So this is it. So mills owner insist that the reason behind their woes is excess production of sugar and fall in its price. So somehow mills are obviously producing sugar, more sugar is there, so somehow it is reducing in price. So it is a problematic. If things in large production and it is in cheaper in number, then payment will not be there. Okay, payment less payment will be there, consumption will be up to a limit, not that much. Okay, so this is it. So they will be earning that thing from the ethanol, from the production of ethanol. Okay, so ethanol production has been additionally facilitated with the government mandating 10% blending with alcohol. Petrol will be blending with ethanol and it will be resulting in better results. Okay, now the next topic is India Justice Report. Okay, so for the first time it is released, which is prepared by the Tata Trust. So basically from the name itself, India Justice Report is a report in which the overall states, the condition of justice in the overall state has been measured. Okay, so prepared by Tata Trust and with the collaboration of Center for Social Justice, Common Cause, Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative, Daksh, TISS Prayas and Vidhi Center for Legal Policy has together combinedly published this report. It is India's first ever ranking of states on the justice delivery. Okay, as we have already discussed, it's the India's largest ranking on states in the justice delivery. All right, so in the list, Maharashtra had topped the list and then later on Kerala and Tamil Nadu are on the second and the third number respectively. Okay, so what were the key issues which were highlighted in the India Justice Report? Okay, so besides topping by the Maharashtra, Kerala and the Tamil Nadu, the key highlights were vacancies was an issue across the pillars of the police, prisons and the judiciary. So there are so many vacancies there already. The country has about 18,200 judges, in which 23% sanction post are still vacant. These posts have been sanctioned, but they are still vacant, out of which women are poorly represented. Women are not there that much. Okay, even prisons in the country are occupied 114%. This is the condition where 68% are under trial awaiting. For 114% up to 114% prisons are filled. All right, and the there are under trial, 68% are under trial awaiting injustice. People are there in the jail itself, they are not having the trial, they are not getting investigation, they are inquired. So they are awaiting for it. Okay, then nationally high vacancies in the justice system. So there is an still high vacancy in the justice system, and obviously two states have met the 80% of SC/ST OBC reservation. So there are only two states followed and they have high vacancy in the prison staff. So still they are having high agency, the vacancy for the prison staff is high. Okay, so this is also important. Now the next and the last topic is Feni River and its significance. So why we are discussing it? Because a memorandum of understanding has been signed between India and the Bangladesh. That means there is a withdrawal of 1.82 cubic cusecs of water from the Feni River by India for drinking water supply scheme for Subroom town in the Tripura. So there is a town in Tripura which is known as Subroom town, and there is like a withdrawal of water will be done by the India, and that is 1.82 cusec, okay, cubic feet per second. Okay, so what, where is the Feni River? So the Feni River forms in the India-Bangladesh border. Okay, so basically it is in the India-Bangladesh border, and which originates in the South Tripura district. So basically it is originating from the South Tripura district and passes through Subroom town on the Indian side. And it is passes through the Subroom town and it meets the Bay of Bengal after it flows into Bangladesh. So this is about the Feni River. Now what is the dispute? So till then, till now, no water sharing agreement has been done in the Feni previously. So the dispute over sharing the water river has been long standing. So it was the long standing, but now they have been signed. So recently in August 2019, there was a water security secretary level meeting, which was known as Joint River Commission JRC in Dhaka, happened, in which a pure water sharing agreement, a water sharing agreement have been prepared for the seven rivers, out of which one them is Manu, then Muri, Khowai, Gumti, Dharla, Dudhkumar, and the last one is the Feni. Okay, so the in the memorandum of understanding, now there will be a water benefit of water in the Subroom town on the southern tip of the Tripura. Okay, so this was the dispute, and now with the help of this, around 7,000 population of Subroom town will be getting the water. Alright, so this was about it, and this was today's lecture, and be safe, and we are going to make more awesome videos, and if you guys like this video, please rate, review, comment. Okay, if there is any problem too, just make me know in the comment section. I will try to combat that problem as well. Okay, thanks for watching, and have a nice day.